Dr. Ebony A. Utley. I'm an assistant professor of communication studies at California State University, Long Beach. I'm also an author. I was born in Indianapolis, Indiana. I got my undergraduate degree from Indiana University, Bloomington, and my master's and my PhD from Northwestern University in Evanston, Illinois. And a lady never tells her age. I've been teaching for about 8 years. I've been at Long Beach State for 5 years. I'm starting my sixth year in 2011. I teach classes in rhetorical criticism. I also teach classes on hip hop, gender, and problem solving. I teach mostly upper division courses. So my courses are 300 and 400 level courses, mostly with juniors and with seniors. Probably the most challenging class to teach is rhetorical criticism. At Long Beach State, we call it Com 301. And that class is an intense class. It requires an immense amount of reading and an immense amount of writing. The students really learn to analyze public communication in the class. So they learn to pick it apart, they improvise their critical thinking skills, and they learn to pull apart communication in different ways to figure out how it works. So we study how individuals use symbols to build up their communities, and how they also use symbols to tear down these communities. So the rhetorical criticism class is a foundational class in education. The hip-hop criticism class builds on the rhetorical criticism class. Essentially, we talk about how hip-hop came to be the way it is today, and we talk about race, we talk about gender, we talk about class, we talk about sexuality, we talk about religion, we talk about ethnicity, and how all those different pieces of the puzzle help us understand hip-hop today. So once we know the background about hip-hop, we can understand how it's changed over time. My pop culture class is about pop culture writ large. It includes a little hip-hop, it also includes a little criticism, but we look at pop culture, we look at music, we look at films, we look at television, we look at sports, we also talk about food, and we analyze how and why popular culture brings us pleasure, and we talk about who has power in popular culture. But perhaps my favorite class to teach is the gender class, because in the gender class, the students get to know me a little bit better. I get to use lots of my personal experiences about what it's been like for me to be a little girl in the world, what it's been like for me to be a grown black woman in the world, and the students also get to share their experiences when we talk about what it means to be a man, what it means to be a woman, and how those terms are socially constructed, and there isn't anything biological behind them, but something that shifts over time, and also shifts and varies depending upon which culture you're in. I decided when I was 19 that I wanted to get a PhD, because I wanted to be the type of woman that I didn't have an opportunity to study with. I was looking for someone that was young, someone that was hip, someone that was cool, someone that was interested in social justice. That individual didn't exist when I was in the middle of southern Indiana, surrounded by lots of white folks. So I decided I wanted to go to Northwestern, I wanted to get the PhD to be that person for other students. And it hasn't been easy. I was a graduate student at Northwestern. I remember I was by myself in the office late one night, and one of the faculty comes in and says to me, "You know, Ebony, we never thought you would make it here. Yeah, your interests don't really fit with everyone else's interests, and we just didn't think that you would be successful." And then she turned around and left. And I thought, who does that? But again, it wasn't a deterrent. I really wanted to be at Northwestern. I really wanted to get this PhD, and I pushed my way through. It was difficult for me to find an advisor. There were lots of changes in the department, and I felt like I was sort of riding on my own for a really long time. But eventually, everything worked out. My perseverance. Sometimes I say that I moved mountains with the sheer force of my will. I just kept approaching people, asking them to sit on my committee, asking for advice. I continued to read. I continued to write. So even when I felt like there wasn't a strong support team, I still did everything that I knew how to do to push myself to the next level, and eventually someone came along to take my hand and pull me up to the next step. Oftentimes, when I'm at my job, my office is along a hallway with lots of other individuals' offices. Strangers to the department will still pop their heads in and say to me, "Do you work here?" Of course, I work here. My name is on the door. But no one suspects like a really young African-American woman to be a professor in a department. So most times people are just surprised actually that I exist because, as I said at the beginning of the story, I wanted to be the woman that didn't exist when I was going to school. So my biggest challenges haven't just been challenges because I'm a woman, but also because I'm an African-American woman. It's difficult for people to sometimes take me seriously because I look too young, or I look the wrong color, or perhaps I'm the wrong gender, but it's never slowed me down. Just continue to persevere, and eventually, I arrive where I'm supposed to be. I think I have made an impact on my colleagues. Being, to my knowledge, the first African-American woman on the tenure track in my department, I think it's significant to my colleagues to see me at the table with them. Everyone in the department treats me with respect. I had a colleague who must have been at least in his 70s. Every time he saw me, he'd refer to me as Dr. Utley. And I would say to him, please, call me by my first name. It's really awkward when you call me Dr. Utley. I think he'd been in the system more years than I have been alive. But yes, I don't have any major problems with any of my colleagues. I think they do respect me, and I'm glad to be part of the team. I would absolutely love to be in the same category as someone as Bell Hooks one day. I'm not there yet, but it's certainly one of my goals. She's definitely one of my sheroes. I love her work. I love her career trajectory. And she's definitely one of the women that I completely admire. Sonia Sanchez is another woman that I just love and admire. Her poetry is amazing. Her ability to condense life experiences and relationships into the tiny haikus is simply beautiful. There's no poetess on earth that writes like Sonia Sanchez writes. So I would also hope one day to write things as impactfully as she does. In terms of people that I have influenced, at some level, you just might not ever know. I mean, I teach about 100 students a semester, and you never know which students may never contact you again but remember something that you said or something that you did in the classroom. I always try to take my embodiment very seriously, though, because I know for a lot of students, this might be the only time in their lives that they interact with a professional Black woman with a PhD, so I want them to have had a positive experience with me. That doesn't mean that they have to like me. It just means that they should perhaps respect me or respect the things that I have been able to accomplish or the things that I tried to teach them. I have had female students tell me that they learned a lot from me, that they think of me as a mentor. Perhaps the most flattering gift is when they come back and ask for advice about what they're doing next in life. Should I marry this man? Should I follow through with this relationship or should I end it? Should I attend graduate school? Should I get a PhD? Should I stop at the master's? What kind of career should I pursue? I've even had students approach me about their spiritual paths in life, and I always find that kind of odd. It's like, what happened between us throughout the semester that made you think I would be able to help you with these questions? So I think some of the students see themselves as having a stronger relationship with me than perhaps I'm able to see with them because there are so many of them. But I always welcome my students to come back to me and talk to me about their lives, and when they do, at that point, I really get to know them. I really get to know who they are and what their interests are, and some of my students I even count now as friends, like after they've graduated and moved on in life. So I'd like to think that I have made an impact, but my ego is not that big, and I'm assuming that I'm making a grand impact like many of the women that I admire. I still got a good 10 years left before I'm even kind of sort of close to being in the running with someone like Bellows. I'm a social critic. I do my social criticism through my writing. I'm a regular blogger for Ms. Magazine, for Religion Dispatches, and also for Truth Dig. When I'm writing for Ms., I write a lot about women and their relationships. I write a lot about how gender is socially constructed in our society, and about how a lot of the expectations for what it means to be a woman in our society are unrealistic. For Religion Dispatches, I write a lot about the relationship between rap music and religion. I've written several pieces about Jay-Z. I've debunked the myth that Jay-Z is a devil worshiper. Just so we're clear, Jay-Z is not a devil worshiper, and neither is Kanye. I've also written essays about Jay-Z and his experiences with religion and his relationship between religion and money. For Truth Dig, so far, I'm a straight-up reviewer, so I review a lot of pop culture books for them. I reviewed Terrence Dean's Mogul, and I also reviewed Sister Soulja's Midnight and the Meaning of Love. I've been quoted several times in the Ms. magazine. I am also the author of a couple of books. There's an edited volume called Power and Pleasure in Popular Culture that will be out at the end of 2011. And I'm also working on a book titled Rap and Religion. My first book is titled Rap and Religion, Understanding the Gangsta's God. Essentially, the book explains how and why rappers talk about God. Now, when I talk about gangsters, I'm not talking about gang members, and I'm not talking about gangsters with the mafia or organized crime. Instead, I'm talking about gangsta as a persona, as an identity that young urban people put on to make themselves feel more powerful in the world. Being able to brag about how gangsta you are is a rhetorical strategy that lots of individuals use when they don't have money, when they don't have education, when they don't have other advancement opportunities. They hold on to a gangsta ethos so that they feel strong, so that they feel invincible. God is another figure that's strong, that's invincible. It doesn't matter who you are or where you are. If you've got God on your side, God is going to ride or die for you. So that's what I mean with the gangsta's God. It's not a religious concept. Despite the title, the book really isn't about religion. Instead, it's about how rappers use God to talk about religious issues. How they use God to defend themselves when they feel like they're being attacked by outside society. How they use God to make themselves seem larger than life when they have other rappers who are coming from their top spot on the charts. How they use God to replace fathers that they never had. How they call themselves gods so that they feel more empowered and powerful when they're running around on the streets. So Rap and Religion, Understanding the Gangsta's God is the first book of its kind. It's the first single author book to really talk about rap music and religion. It covers over 100 songs and videos spanning from the 1980s to the mid-2011. I'm really excited about the project. It's being published with Prager and it will be out in 2012. I reside on the web at theutleyexperience.com. The Utley Experience is where I archive all of my work. It's where you can go for updates on Rap and Religion and Power and Pleasure and any of my other future projects. It's also the site where you can access all of my YouTube videos and my lectures and presentations on the web. There's a funny story behind the Utley Experience, though. I was thinking of myself as a professor, but I also wanted to think of myself as an author and a writer in the mainstream culture. And one of my friends says to me, "You know, Ebony, you're not anyone unless you're Googleable." Okay, well I guess I need to become Googleable. But you can't just put your name in Google and be Googleable, you also have to have a brand. I was resistant to the idea of brands. My people were slaves, I can't brand myself, that's a problem. It just was really uncomfortable with this idea of branding. So I did what any good academic would do. I went to the library and I got a book on social media and branding. The more I started to read about it, the more I realized that this is where the 2000s are going. The 21st century is about branding. It's about marketing. It's about having a place where people can go so that they can access your ideas. I often refer to myself as the woman with ideas, and all those ideas are cataloged on theutleyexperience.com. We hope to see you there soon. I am Dr. Ebony A. Utley, and this is My Life and Love.